On this edition of The Fifth Estate, her name is Lucy. She's Edmonton's one and only elephant, which means she may well be the northernmost elephant in the world.
Canada is a wonderful place, and I love Canadians. I love them on Price is Right. I love the country, but it ain't no place for elephants.
Come.
Now, Lucy's at the very heart of the bitter fight over the future of elephants in zoos.
Lucy's been with her handlers for most of them into their third decade. These handlers are her family.
They're so desperate to hold on to elephants. It's like this is a prized possession that I think maybe they just cannot see the truth.
Free the elephants! Free the elephants!
The lines have been drawn from Edmonton to Toronto.
We can't just throw our elephants out to the sanctuary because some people went there. This is ridiculous.
Ahead, what some zoos will do to keep them.
For Maggie, they actually brought in a treadmill.
Literally.
There's a treadmill, an elephant treadmill.
We built one for $150,000.
And why TV legends are campaigning to let the elephants go.
These people are filled with the same empathy we are, but for some reason, and I don't know the reasons, they're keeping Lucy there.
The question on this Fifth Estate: could Canada's elephants be the beginning of the end for the world's zoos?
Hello, I'm Bob McKeown. Welcome to the Fifth Estate. They call them charismatic megafauna, which translates to the attention-getting large animals that are zoo headliners that bring the people through the front gates. And make no mistake about it, there are a lot of customers. According to the Association of Zoos and Aquariums in North America, more people go to zoos every year than attend professional sporting events. 175 million of them, creating billions and billions of dollars worth of revenue. Which explains why the fight over Canada's elephants has become so heated and controversial. They are first and foremost gigantic, two or three times the weight of a car, perhaps as tall as the room you're in now. At once plodding, yet graceful, good-natured, but with lethal power. The largest animal to walk the earth is distinguished not only by its sheer size, but also by intelligence, sociability, and family ties. Internationally known zoo director and architect David Hancock.
It's difficult to describe how sociable elephants are. I mean, the females, the matriarchal society that they have, a female born into that group will never be separated from its mother, its sister, its aunts, its grandmothers. They're always together, they're always in touch. The only way they lose each other is through death.
It's what happened to Lucy when she was orphaned in the wilds of Sri Lanka at the age of two, then sold to the Edmonton Valley Zoo.
Good girl.
She's been there for more than 30 years now, for over a decade and a half of it, without the company of other elephants. The Edmonton Valley Zoo's veterinarian, Dr. Milton Ness, says Lucy no longer needs elephants.
Lucy was an elephant that was raised in companionship with people, and she derives a tremendous amount of her social needs from the people that she's around.
You okay? Nice catch your tongue.
I believe that she's very comfortable and quite content with the kind of companionship that she receives on a day-to-day basis.
Except she doesn't really have a choice now.
Well,
she's stuck with people whether she wants them or not.
She's been with elephants in the past, and in the past she hasn't formed strong bonds with those elephants. So, and she has been with people all along, and she's formed very good and complete bonds with the people she's been around.
After decades working with zoos on three continents, David Hancock doesn't buy that.
I use the word delusion, and I don't use that term lightly. And I think when people say, we've been looking after an elephant, she's a people elephant, they know nothing about elephants, people who would say that. It's more than just a zoo-centric view. It's like, I mean, it's a completely blinkered view of reality. There's no way an elephant can become a people elephant. She's forced to have some sort of social interaction with some living thing, and the only thing that's there are people.
Let's go, move. Good girl.
It seems that Lucy is well cared for in Edmonton.
Good, move.
Between them, her main keepers have been with her for decades, though they do carry the controversial iron rods known as bull hooks. In the time we spent with them, they treated her with gentleness and respect. But for some, the issue is far more fundamental.
Good girl.
I don't care how much they love an elephant or how much they think the elephant loves them. That elephant would rather be with other elephants than with them. And that's the case of this one elephant, Lucy, up there in Canada.
Here is the star, the price is right, Bob!
Now in his late 80s, the former game show host Bob Barker is still a television icon. Though today he's almost as well known as an activist for animal rights.
Have your pets bayed or neutered.
Especially for elephants in zoos, like Lucy in Edmonton.
If she is confined, and she is 75% of the year in Canada. Canada is a wonderful place, and I love Canadians. I love them on Price is Right, and I love the country, but it ain't no place for elephants.
A few years ago, Barker became the front man for the campaign to relocate Lucy from Edmonton to a wildlife sanctuary in the U.S. The Free Lucy movement argues that both in climate and space, she's about as far as she can get from her natural habitat, where elephants travel to find food and water, often more than 20 kilometers a day.
But it's not just the walking. The elephants are walking, and they're active, and they're interacting with their environment, and they're tearing limbs off trees, and they're a very super aware sort of animal. You put it into a zoo enclosure, nothing ever changes in that enclosure. They come out of their barn door every morning. It's identical to what it was yesterday.
But Edmonton Zoo vet Milton Ness insists for Lucy, life in Edmonton is as fulfilling as it could be.
Are you happy now? You're very happy, good girl.
Lucy's grown up here. Lucy has lived in this environment virtually her whole life and does very well. We have created some policies and procedures just to make sure that nothing bad happens. Basically, Lucy goes for a walk throughout the zoo every day of the year, except on those days when it's below minus 20 degrees Celsius, which is not that many days in the year.
Daddy? After the break, if you have to relocate a 4-ton elephant, how exactly do you do it? As you'll see, carefully. Very carefully. To truly understand the battle over the future of elephants in zoos, it's necessary to go even farther north than Edmonton.
Hi, Maggie. Hi, Maggie.
Because several years ago, before there was Lucy, there was Maggie, also living in a zoo, far from where she was born, in Africa, in the definitely not-so-tropical climes of Anchorage, Alaska. Patrick Lampe is director of the Alaska Zoo. He acknowledges that Anchorage, like Edmonton, is not the ideal elephant habitat.
Well, for us in Anchorage, it was the cold weather, number one, and the length of the winter. So there was a good 6 months of the year where she got to go out very little, just on exceptionally warm days when there wasn't any wind and the snow conditions were right.
And like Lucy, Maggie also was alone, deprived of that crucial contact with other elephants.
The social interaction, they coo to each other, they touch each other, the stimulation, the companionship, they depend more upon that, more so than a lot of other species.
Still, when the Free Maggie movement began, Patrick Lampe, who once was Maggie's handler himself, insisted he wouldn't let his elephant go anywhere.
I was one of the people that just like, hey, don't tell us what to do up here. You know, it's our elephant and she's fine.
And as the debate grew in Anchorage, so did opposition to a move.
She's been a part of our lives, and this is her home, the only home she's known all of her life.
They wanted her to stay no matter what. You know, this was her home. She doesn't know how to be with other elephants. She's used to the cold. You know, we love her, she loves us. They were passionate and they were completely sincere.
With passions running so high on both sides, the Alaska Zoo investigated what elephant experts thought should be done with Maggie. They consulted 10 of them, all recognized authorities in the field. The response was overwhelming.
Was there consensus among these people?
Yeah, it was pretty much a major consensus that for the Alaska Zoo, they said, you know, she should not be by herself and she should not be in that cold weather.
Of those 10 experts, 9 said Maggie definitely should be moved. But desperate to keep her, instead the zoo listened to the lone holdout. Dr. James Oosterhuis of San Diego said Maggie could stay in Anchorage even without another elephant, as long as the Alaska Zoo made changes to her enclosure and routine. Estimated cost, about $300,000.
We expanded the building, we expanded their outdoor area, we all new heating, lighting, and ventilation.
And Dr. Oosterhuis had another suggestion, an elephant-sized treadmill, 6 meters long, weighing over 7,000 kilograms, so Maggie could get exercise, even in wintertime.
That literally was a suggestion.
We built one for $150,000.
And did it get the desired result?
No. No, she did not want to walk on it.
In all, Dr. Oosterhuis's recommendations went so far over budget, ultimately costing $1.2 million, they almost bankrupted the zoo.
Maggie was all alone. No matter how well they are fed or how well they're housed, an elephant that is alone is miserable.
When TV legend and animal rights advocate Bob Barker learned about Maggie's condition, he leapt right in and flew to Anchorage.
Even I could see that Maggie was not well. She was so thin that her hide was just hanging on her, and she had fallen twice and couldn't get up. You looked into her eyes and they were just hopeless. There was no hope in her eyes at all.
The final straw was when the fire department rescue squad had to come to get Maggie back on her feet.
That happened twice to us, and at one time she was down for 12 hours. And that's a really long time for an elephant to be down. Of course, she's in pain and doesn't know you're trying to help, so she's lashing out with her trunk and her feet. And it was wild. And it was scary.
The question now wasn't if Maggie should go, but where. Before long, the answer seemed obvious. At first glance, the Paws Animal Sanctuary in Northern California, operated by the Performing Animal Welfare Society, could be the savannah of Southern Africa or Southeast Asia. It's 2,300 acres. They're populated by 27 tigers, 7 bears, 5 lions, and by 8 elephants, both African and Asian, all either rescued or retired from zoos or circuses. Pat Derby was once a Hollywood animal trainer on classic TV series like Lassie and Flipper. Then, 28 years ago, she and partner Ed Stewart founded a sanctuary where performing animals like elephants could peacefully live out their lives.
We live for moments where they act like an elephant. You know, they might eat a tree, or they might graze or get in the mud. Those are little moments that they would do if they were wild. And those are the little successes that you have throughout the day. We always wanted a place where the elephants could go somewhere and you can't find them. And so we finally have it.
Remember, Alaska Zoo officials adamantly resisted any move for Maggie, at least until they saw Paws.
It was just such a peaceful setting, as close as you could get maybe on this continent for elephants. Yeah, it felt right. And I liked what they said. You know, they said, moving the elephant is your decision. You know, that's your decision, that's not ours. If you do want to move the elephant, we're here to help you.
Paws veterinarian Mel Richardson went to examine Maggie.
After seeing that she'd already been down twice and we're going into the winter again, I thought, she's going to die. She's going to die there. I mean, what have we got to lose by moving her?
But there was still the not inconsequential matter of how to transport an elephant weighing 4 tons, more than 4,000 kilometers.
Hey, Max, good girl, come on.
A lot of things could go wrong. You've got a lot of heavy equipment. You've got a 8,000-pound animal that has the potential to get very excited.
Steady.
Trucking Maggie from Alaska to California could be too long and hard on her. But even a 747 wasn't big enough to fly her there. Then, out of the blue, Patrick Lampe got a phone call from the U.S. Air Force Base in Anchorage.
One of the people called up and said, you know, we've heard about you guys being interested in moving an elephant, and we've got the aircraft to do it.
It was a brand new C-17 transport, the largest American military aircraft. So it was that on November 1st, 2007, after weeks of training,
that's a good girl, Maggie,
and accompanied by handlers old and new, Maggie boarded the massive cargo plane bound for her new home at the Paz Sanctuary in San Andreas, California. It was something never done before, and everyone knew that one way or another, the stakes could literally be life or death.
If we're right, then Maggie's going to win from that. And if she does die in the shipment, well, she's probably going to die where she is.
But later that night, there she was, safe and sound in California. The next morning, she was carefully unloaded at Paz, greeted by Pat Derby. Maggie seemed almost giddy.
Woo-hoo! Maggie, that's good. That's good.
After a transitional period of 10 days, Maggie finally was introduced to her new family of female African elephants. This is video of that very moment. Maggie, on the right, the smallest one, approaching the first elephant she'd seen in years. Cautiously, as pachyderms do, rear end first. That was 5 years ago. They've been inseparable ever since.
What's the biggest difference? Behaviorally, what's the litmus test when they come here?
Well, when they lie down and sleep is a big one. That makes you feel that they're comfortable. That's one of the goals. To get them to sleep, to get down on the ground, either to wallow in mud or put themselves in a vulnerable position with the other elephants.
Today, there's no question of the trust between Maggie and her best female friends. While she sleeps, they stand guard. The notion that zoos are simply inadequate to give elephants the lives they need is nothing new. Many of the world's best-known facilities have already retired their elephants or announced their intention to do so. The London and Edinburgh zoos in Britain, the Bronx Zoo in New York, the Lincoln Park Zoo in Chicago, even the Calgary Zoo. But in Toronto, there was about to be a battle royale over the future of its three elephants, Tika, Toka, and Oringa.
Free the elephants!
Free the elephants!
We can't just throw our elephants out to the sanctuary because some people went there. This is ridiculous.
When we come back.
I would characterize the Toronto Zoo elephant placement as just chaos from the top to the bottom.
Send the elephants to Paz!
And in the middle of the chaos, Toronto's elephants. They say if you don't have an elephant, you can't call yourself a zoo.
You guys are lucky, because today we have Toka that's going to be helping us out.
And since it opened in 1974, the Toronto Zoo has had elephants. In all, 12 of them. Over the years, 7 died, and 2 were transferred to other zoos. The surviving 3, Tika, Toka, and Oringa, are all African females in their 30s and 40s.
Toka here is estimated to be about 42 years old.
For elephants in captivity, they're the twilight years. Then in 2011, a surprise announcement. The city-owned zoo decided to phase out its elephant program. But first, it would find the elephants the best possible retirement home. Compared to Edmonton and Alaska, it all seemed so rational and calm. The Toronto Zoo Board drew up a list of criteria for a potential new home for its elephants. It had to have elephants already, and the room to accommodate more. It had to be willing to accept elephants past breeding age, as was the case with the three from Toronto. And it had to be a place which did not use metal bull hooks for discipline. Add it all up, and there was one candidate which met all the criteria. The Paws Sanctuary here in California. At Paws, the elephants live with others of the same species and gender. The three female African elephants are one such group. There's Mara, Lulu, and since she arrived from Alaska, Maggie.
Good girl, Mag. Come on, Maggie.
With over 2,300 acres, 80 for the female Africans alone, as an elephant habitat, Paws clearly compares favorably to almost any zoo, including Toronto's.
Our sanctuary has obviously more space and more diversity.
How much more?
At least 40 times more, I would guess, something like that. They almost can't go anywhere without going up or down a hill, which just makes the texture of their lives a little different. You know, they can, you know, go up higher where they can see. They can get on different sides of the hill. Certain times of the year, the grass is really tall and green, and they eat a lot of grass. They have just little snippets of a normal life.
It's that glimpse of normal life for elephants that sets apart the Paws Sanctuary. By comparison, Toronto's three elephants share an enclosure not of 80 acres, but less than 2 acres, much of it concrete. So when it was decided to close the elephant exhibit, it shouldn't have been a surprise they might consider sending the elephants to Paws, which has an international reputation.
There's no place, there's no accredited zoo that can beat Paws. It's the state of the art, it's the best facility that you can send them to.
Toronto City Councillor Michelle Berardinetti has taken an active role in the debate over the elephants. She's visited Paws and says the choice couldn't be better.
It's exactly as they say. It has natural substrate, it has a heated barn. They have choice on whether to go into the barn or whether they want to go into the 80 acres. The 80 acres is just the enclosure for those female African elephants.
Okay, so Councillor De Beermaker's motion, all in favor.
But though the Paws Sanctuary met all the Toronto Zoo's requirements, the only candidate to do so, there would be a problem.
We have to understand what we're doing here. We can't just throw our elephants out to the sanctuary because some people went there.
First, zoo officials complained that Paws isn't accredited by the U.S.-based Association of Zoos and Aquariums, known as AZA, the most powerful organization in the zoo industry. Then AZA began weighing in itself, arguing that the only way to assure that these elephants receive the highest level of care is to send them to an AZA-accredited facility. And they took aim at Paws directly, saying non-accredited zoos and private elephant facilities, so-called sanctuaries, are not an appropriate alternative. When he was director of the Seattle Zoo, David Hancox was an AZA member. He says what he sees now is an embattled organization trying to protect its turf.
The AZA has gone out of its way to vilify the sanctuaries. They've told all sorts of wrong stories. They put out wrong information. They criticize them very, very harshly. They don't want the public embarrassment of the public knowing that the conditions in zoos are so bad that they have to go to a sanctuary.
Executive Director Ed Stewart acknowledges Paws is not accredited by AZA. He says that's because it's a sanctuary, not a zoo or aquarium. And he maintains living conditions there are far better than at many facilities which are AZA accredited.
If they wanted to give me an accreditation tomorrow, I wouldn't take it because they have facilities, number one, that use bull hooks, number two, that do circus acts with their elephants, number three, use electric shock on their elephants. And so we don't want to do it. We wouldn't do it.
But as you'll see, the fight was just beginning.
I would characterize the Toronto Zoo elephant placement as just chaos from the top to the bottom.
Okay, so our last item, moving the three Toronto Zoo elephants.
In the midst of Az's lobbying campaign, Toronto City Council met and discussed what to do next. Almost 6 months had passed since the original decision to move the elephants.
Don't defer this through another winter. You will have the life of an elephant on your hands.
But they seem destined to spend another winter in Toronto.
That's all that we care about. What is in the best interest of these three elephants who have served Toronto and served the Toronto Zoo for all of their lives? And now they deserve to retire and should go to the best facility. Why wouldn't we care about that?
Torontonians have spoke. 74% are in favor of these elephants being put to the sanctuary.
In the end, council voted to pass a motion presented by Michelle Berardinetti.
The motion carries 31-4.
By a resounding margin, it decided to send Tika, Toka, and Aringa to the Paz Sanctuary in California after all. And right away, the Azza lobbying campaign began again, urging the zoo to get city council to reverse its decision, warning that if not, we cannot predict possible actions that might be taken.
Free the elephants! Free the elephants!
It's all fanned the flames of public opinion on both sides of the issue.
Make the decision that makes the most sense. Don't evict our elephants.
What do we want?
In the war over elephants and zoos, it seems Toronto is now ground zero. Which may well be why, in the spring of 2012, the Association of Zoos and Aquariums denied the Toronto Zoo's accreditation, not for mistreating animals, but because City Council had voted to send their elephants to Paws. Loss of accreditation could severely limit the acquisition of new animals for the Toronto Zoo. But David Hancock believes it's all part of the Azza strategy to keep control of its headline animals, the charismatic megafauna the zoo business is built on.
What they're doing, in fact, of course, is sending a warning shot across the bow of every other city council in North America, saying if you even think of removing your elephants to a sanctuary, we're going to take your accreditation away.
Send the elephants to Paws!
So the front lines are drawn on both sides, those proclaiming concern for the elephants. In the middle, Toka, Tika, and Aringa themselves, alongside the crates in which they may or may not be transported to California.
I've visited Paws, and I think it is the nearest possible thing to the elephant's natural habitat.
Bob Barker left no doubt where he stands when Pat Derby of Paws asked if he'd help pay for the difficult and very expensive elephant relocation, should it ever take place.
She said it would cost around $880,000. I said, I have $880,000 and I'll be happy to pay it. I want them to fly.
Wow.
Rather than go by truck. So she said, great, that's great.
In Toronto, it all dragged on and on. For months, we attempted to contact a representative of the Toronto Zoo to ask them to speak with us. And for months, they refused even to respond. Finally, as we finished this program, they officially denied our request for an interview.
I'd like to begin.
And a year and a half after their original decision to relocate the elephants, Toronto Zoo officials are still resisting the move.
My name's John Traconia, and I'm the CEO here at the Toronto Zoo.
At a recent news conference, they gave reasons for the delay, raising questions about record keeping, about the aircraft that would transport the elephants.
Our repeated requests for outstanding records of health have not been answered in a sufficient and professional manner.
All intended to further drag out the process, yes, according to Michelle Berardinetti.
Yes. It's all stall tactics, it's all smoke and mirrors, and again, it's all because they don't want to send them to a facility that's not accredited by their own insiders club.
But then came this bombshell from the Toronto Zoo's chief vet.
It has come to light that animals at Paws in the last a year and a half to date have died from tuberculosis at Paws.
Ed Stewart says that's simply not true. He insists no elephants have ever died at Paws because of TB.
Well, the truth is that they either died or were euthanized because of arthritis. And it showed that they did have tuberculosis, but it wasn't what killed them.
Dealing with tuberculosis is commonplace for those who work with elephants. What's more, Counselor Berardinetti says, because TB can be passed to animals from people, the odds of contracting it are far greater at a zoo than at a sanctuary.
I mean, you've got 10 to 15 million North Americans that have been exposed to TB that are going through the Toronto Zoo right now.
And she maintains no one has better infectious disease control than PAWS.
We don't even have standards in Canada for quarantine protocols, but yet PAWS actually set them for the USDA. So to say that they don't have quarantine protocols is, again, it's completely false.
Mama.
And among the female Africans at PAWS, the group Toronto's three elephants would join, there's never been any exposure to TB whatsoever. The bottom line, according to Ed Stewart, is that elephant life expectancy at PAWS is almost twice that of the seven elephants who have died at the Toronto Zoo over the years.
The average age was over 52 years old for the elephants that have died here. The elephants at the Toronto Zoo that have died aren't even 30 years old, the average. So it's kind of a moot point as far as we're concerned. The elephants here are not dying of tuberculosis.
For now, there they remain, Toka, Tika, and Aringa, in their enclosure at the Toronto Zoo, along with the rest of us, waiting for another winter. As is Lucy in Edmonton. The question, when we return, why is Lucy still there? And why is she still alone?
Come.
Out for her daily walk at the Edmonton Valley Zoo, Lucy may not look like the flashpoint for the fight over the future of elephants that she's become. From her enclosure, it's several hundred meters to this wooded area with foliage and a modest mud hole.
How about some grass? Yeah? Let's go this way.
Then it's several hundred meters back again, stopping to scratch at a favorite tree.
You can put your trunk down.
And everywhere are Lucy's admirers. She'll do it all again tomorrow and every day. At least until the Edmonton winter arrives.
Let's go, move. Good girl.
Zoos call this animal handling technique free contact, where elephants are allowed to get close to humans. It's why wherever Lucy goes, her keepers carry the sharpened iron rods, known for public consumption as guides, otherwise called bull hooks. As docile as Lucy may look, and usually is, the fact is elephants weigh 4 or 5 tons, can easily kill a person, intentionally or not.
When you're standing next to an animal that you understand can kill you, and the only thing you have is this little metal instrument, you tend to use it out of fear more than anything else.
Veterinarian Mel Richardson says for the safety of both elephants and keepers, sanctuaries like PAWS use what they call protected contact, in which the animals and humans are given their own space. For Maggie from Alaska and her best female friends, the space they've shared at PAWS for the past 5 years is approximately 80 acres. At the Edmonton Valley Zoo, Lucy's enclosure is less than one.
No elephant's going to be happy in a space no bigger probably than this living room.
Bob Barker, integral in moving Maggie to PAWS, has been no less outspoken about Lucy's living conditions.
She stands in there, and you know, in the Canadian winter, she can't be outside. And when she goes for a walk, what does she do? She walks along with animal keepers with hooks, telling her just what to do and where to go. Elephants, they like to play. They play in mud holes. They play in ponds. And they love to tear up trees and socialize with other elephants. And Lucy has none of that.
Over the years, Lucy has suffered from foot disease, the result of standing and walking on hard surfaces that aren't earth or grass. Foot infection often leads to death for captive elephants.
The first thing that shocked me to a great extent was the number of problems and the amount and scale of the problems of foot rot and the percentage of deaths that came from elephants having problems with their feet in zoos.
A function of the weight of the elephants and the surface,
yes,
in the zoos?
A function of standing on concrete, being chained up all night, standing in their own urine, and they'd be standing on this hard surface, and they would develop foot rot. And this had been going on forever.
It's an inevitable fact of captivity for a species that should be walking up to 20 kilometers a day.
They have to walk. That's what makes their body what it is. Uphill, downhill, not flat. No, they don't need to walk on asphalt roads. They need to be going up and down, digging, and it strengthens their muscles. It creates the elephant is what it does.
Alberta Zoo standards say elephants must be kept in groups of at least three because of the importance to them of sociability and companionship. The Association of Zoos and Aquariums requires the same thing. But Edmonton Valley Zoo has announced that after Lucy, it intends to get out of the elephant business and that acquiring others to keep her company now is out of the question. So why is Lucy still here alone?
They need to be able to do something. They need to be able to exercise their mind, exercise their body, be with their kind.
William Shatner is another Hollywood icon who's joined the campaign to free Lucy.
I feel so callow in telling the Edmonton Zoo what to do. These people are filled with the same empathy we are, but for some reason, and I don't know the reasons, they're keeping Lucy there. But there's every reason to think it's incorrect.
Hey, you. How are you?
But Edmonton Zoo veterinarian Milton Ness claims there's a very good reason to keep Lucy. He maintains an unspecified respiratory problem precludes sending her anywhere.
The act of moving her could threaten her health. Mm-hmm. Not only her health, she could die.
Yeah.
And we've had a number of other individuals who've looked into this and agreed with us.
In fact, who did the Edmonton Zoo hire to decide whether Lucy could be moved to a sanctuary? None other than the very same expert who was the only one of 10 to tell the Alaska Zoo that Maggie could stay there by herself. The man behind that never-used $150,000 elephant treadmill, Dr. James Oosterhuis of San Diego.
He is known as a controversial figure in the industry, is he not?
As with everybody else in this world, people can make decisions about who they want to side with, but we chose Jim Oosterhuis because he was the best person for the job.
That depends on whom you're asking. Mention James Oosterhuis to those who want zoo elephants to retire, and you'll hear he has a record of recommending elephants remain in zoos, even alone, as he did here in Edmonton with Lucy. PAW's veterinarian Mel Richardson.
Jim believes that the current standard of handling elephants is perfectly fine. Perfectly fine in that keeping them by themselves is fine. He doesn't see an issue with it.
In the past, James Oosterhuis has seemed to subscribe to the old school of elephant training. In one notorious case, keepers at an animal park in San Diego chained a misbehaving female elephant named Dunda to the ground and beat her on the head with axe handles for 2 days. This is Dunda beforehand, and here afterwards. You can clearly see the damage done to the top and side of her head. Called to testify about it, Dr. Oosterhuis described the discipline as appropriate and non-harmful, an indication critics say of a pro-zoo bias. He also declined our request for an interview. Dr. Milton Ness says the diagnosis that travel could be dangerous for Lucy does not come from James Oosterhuis alone.
Well, let me be clear, is that we consult with a lot of different individuals. So Jim Oosterhuis has been on site and done the examination. We've been supported in that at all levels from the Edmonton Humane Society, who on a regular basis comes to the zoo. We've had the Alberta government, Fish and Wildlife, who gives the zoo its permit, come in here and support that. The Canadian Association of Zoos and Aquariums has also said that Lucy is best here. For me, given Lucy's health condition, pretty simple, that this is the best place for her. No ifs, ands, or buts.
I don't know whether it's that the people really believe what they say in the zoo world, or they're so desperate to hold on to elephants. It's like this is a prized possession that I think maybe they just cannot see the truth.
And the truth, according to veteran zoo director David Hancock, is that inevitably, starting with elephants, zoos are changing.
I suspect in as soon as 10 years' time, we'll probably hear people saying, how can you call yourself a zoo if you've got an elephant in it? You know, I think we're on the cusp of a major paradigm shift.
Is there a larger issue here, do you think? That this is not only about Lucy or the three elephants at the Toronto Zoo. It's about the future of zoos.
Well, it's the future of zoos, yes. And certainly the future of elephant habitats in zoos. There will be a time that people are going to say, do you know that back there for years, and in 2012 even, they had zoos, they called them. And they took these beautiful animals and they stuffed them in cages. Can you picture that? In cages. Can you imagine that? It was the Dark Ages. Dark Ages. That's what I predict.
As for Lucy in Edmonton, she has not even seen another elephant in over 5 years.
What worries do you have about the future of Lucy should she remain at the Edmonton Valley Zoo?
She doesn't die by herself. I don't think she should die by herself.
Dr. Mel Richardson believes a sanctuary is the best place for Maggie and would be best for Lucy, too.
I think she should have the ability to be with another Asian elephant and at least in the last part of her life, sleep in the sun on a hillside. I just think that's the best we can give her, so why not?